The more annoying Canucks play on words. Bo knows, for a young Bo Horvat, made his NHL debut last night. Or Miller time, for 9-1 Ryan Miller, who was off to a sensational start between the pipes for the Vancouver Canucks. We're both on Miller time here, right?
Yeah, although I think the write-in vote of verbata bing, verbata boom probably does take the cake.
No, I like verbata bing, verbata
boom. You do?
Yep. Yep. It's clever. It's original. It's not a beer slogan or a Nike ad, put it that way.
It's not as on the nose as Miller
time.
That's
true. You have to at least be a little creative on that one.
Yeah, that's true.
Vancouver Canucks give up the first two goals last night in Colorado. Blake, you think, oh my gosh, here we go again. They give up seven last time they were in that building. Maybe their worst loss of the year. The Dallas loss was pretty bad too. And yet here they come storming back with five goals to win the hockey game. Nick Bonino with a pair. He's outpointing Ryan Kessler right now. That second line looked terrific. Without Alex Burrow still serving his suspension as Lyndon Bay moved on to right wing of the second line. But we start our Canucks countdown tonight, or today, with number three, the rookie, the aforementioned rookie, Bo Horvat, on making his NHL debut.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. It's hard to describe. You know, it's a moment I was dreaming. Ever since I was a little kid, I always wanted to play in the NHL, and to finally, you know, make that dream come true today was definitely something special, and I'll never forget this.
Number three, Horvat, on making his NHL debut. We had him on the show here at 11:15. You can log on at tsn1040.ca, catch the podcast of that. I believe it's also going to be on Bar Down, right?
With video.
Yeah,
yes.
With video, Bar Down on tsn.ca. Horvat doesn't play a whole lot, but gets the first face-off of the game alongside Henrik Sedin, who's typically a center. So a very classy move right there by head coach Willie Desjardins to get the kids some sugar right off the bat. Here you go, opening face-off alongside our captain and our number one centerman. And look, had some chances in the first period, Blake.
Had some chances, but
it looked pretty good. Did not look out of place. Someone said last night, did not look out of place. I thought that was a very good comment.
And he won faceoffs, too. I mean, people are going to look at that on this team that has been bad. Now, granted, the Avs are a bad faceoff team as well. So, you know, the Canucks should win that faceoff battle. If there's one team you're gonna try to beat, it's a team like this. But, you know, Horvat goes out and wins a ton of draws, finished 67% in the faceoff circle. And, you know, that's against National Hockey League guys. You know, even if they are the worst, those are NHL pros that he's beaten in the faceoff circle.
Let's hear from head coach Willie Desjardins on Bo Horvat. Come back and discuss his future in terms of how often he's going to get into this lineup. Here's coach Desjardins on Bo Horvat.
It was good for Horvat. He had a real good game for his first game coming in. He played well. It's always good to see a young guy perform like that.
So the question... Burrows comes off suspension tomorrow in San Jose. Does Horvat stay in the lineup?
I think Horvat probably does stay in the lineup. Just to give him some regularity, and then he sits out one of the weekend games in Southern California.
Let me ask you this. Can he stay in the lineup winning faceoffs alone?
Well, no, of course not. No, I mean,
But they've been so poor in the faceoff circle.
Yeah.
Could you see a scenario where if, in fact, he is still winning faceoffs, that they use him in a spot capacity like last night, limited minutes, but he takes some draws?
Well, it would be great to see is them get a lead on one of these three teams so they can give him some prime time against who knows how he's going to face, you know, fare in the faceoff circle against Kopitar. Against
Jared Stoll.
Joe Thornton, Jared Stoll. I mean, that would be interesting. He's not taking those draws right now. Let's see how he would do in the circle with those guys. Then, if he shows well, then you could start to go down the road. But you're not going to throw him out there against those guys in a tight game on the road.
All right. That's number three on the Canucks countdown. Number two, Nick Bonino. The new second-line center, of course, came over in the trade with Anaheim for Ryan Kessler. Bonino, thus far, 6 goals, 11 points. Kessler, 3 goals, 8 points. 2 more yesterday. Let's take a listen.
Benino lets it go, finds Bay. Bay with Higgins appearing in off the point, hits him left wing side. Backdoor play, Benino scores! What a passing play by the Canucks, who bank another into the empty cage pass Varlamov, and they've swung in front 3-2. He's trying to protect long enough to get someone in the picture, finds Benino, and he'll play it through a hole. He scores! No room for Benino, but he'll make room anyway, and a softy beats Varlamov. Canucks up 4-2.
Varlamov gave him very little net, though. That he picked a sliver of net from tight quarters. Blake, we have seen several goal scorers' goals here out of Nick Bonino in the early going.
He's got a heck of a shot. He's faster, I think, than a lot of people give him credit for. You know, he's been an absolute revelation to most of us. I mean, some of them, people that we talked to, I think Ray Ferraro was one guy who said, you're going to love this guy.
Yeah.
And that he isn't a product of Perry and Getzlaf. And that's the biggest thing, is he came with that expectation. Oh, he was on the power play with those guys. You know, that was purely, he's a third liner at best, really, because he's generating second line offense at a rate that befits second line production. I mean, he's almost a point per game here. For a lot of teams, that's their top line.
And, Blake, here's the other thing. Remember when Kessler scored the 41 goals a few years ago? A lot of talk in this market about that wrist shot and how good that wrist shot was. He was scoring goals from distance, picking corners, yeah. Heavy. And he talked about how much he worked on it that summer and how it became an offensive weapon. And, of course, there was the story that, you know, when Matt Sundin came here for his half season with the Canucks and Kessel moved to right wing, that was one of the things that Sundin told him, look, kid, you got a good shot. Keep shooting the puck. I'm not so sure that Bonino's wrist shot would be the heaviest or the fastest or anything like that, but it's darn accurate.
Mm-hmm.
And give me accuracy over what we saw from Kessler the last couple of years, which was really missing the net too often. Missing the net.
And telegraphed.
Telegraphed
Bonino's
and missing the
quicker.
Net. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes it goes around the end boards. It's coming back up the other way. You get it on net, it's a good play.
Yep.
And he gets it on net more often than not. Let's hear from Bonino after the fact.
We got a big goal there from Hank, and I thought we played a pretty solid 60 minutes tonight. You know, they had the lead, but after those two goals, Millsy shut the door really well, and we were never down. We were up. We were positive the whole time.
Millsy, hadn't heard that one yet.
No.
Yeah. He mentions the Henrik Sedin goal. And Henrik Sedin's fifth goal of the season, it comes with just seconds left in the second period where the Canucks have, well, really, through a couple of periods there, ho-hum. And five goals, by the way, on just 18 shots this year for Henrik Sedin. That's really the catalyst. You go into the second intermission with momentum, feeling good about yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And next thing you know, it's a four-goal third period.
Which brings us to the final element of the countdown.
Number one, the comeback. Down 2-0, five goals in the final, 20 minutes and 4 seconds. Henrik Sedin, Bonino with two, Derek Dorsett with his second of the season, and Sean Mathias with his first. And I think, look, with regards to Mathias, well, I'll tell you what, let's listen to Mathias' goal, then come back and talk a little bit about Mathias over the last week.
Landeskog, pass picked off, intended for him. In comes Mathias, off the post, he scores! The first for Sean Mathias is the fifth for Vancouver as they pull in front by 3 in the third.
And the way he had been playing, you knew that first goal was just around the corner. And you wonder at this point now, okay, Mathias, with his first 8 games, self-admitted, he was crappy. Are we going to see the best of this player at this point? Big body going into California against the big body
perfect.
Teams. The timing here works out something.
Absolutely. It is perfect timing for him to be coming into form. Now, in terms of the comeback as a whole, that last second goal in the second period is big. Although I will refer to that Dallas game where they're down 6-2 going into the third period. And you're thinking, okay, now they'll just give up. I mean, they're down 4 goals. You know, despite the fact they had 18 shots in the second period in Dallas, you know, they're going to know there's just not enough time. They ended up having a 16-shot third period. They didn't give up. So while it's an easy narrative to fall into of, oh, if they don't score that last second goal in the second period, there's no way they're coming back. Yeah, I understand why people say that, and you never know. But history tells us outside of that Denver game where they did mail it in, it was a disaster. You know, they've stuck to it. Their shots have been unbelievable this game. Again, third in the league this season for shots on goal. They have been peppering goalies, and when you do that, good things happen.